continuat în lecțiile de studii me Alexandru Vakulovski. I cili është pjesë e rezidencës për artist të organizume për i qembës Multimedia dhe të mbështetën nga traduki. Rezidenca e artistëve është një rezidencë, është një program një mujor ku artist prej krejt botës mund me apliku edhe me arme në kalu një mujë në Prishtinë dhe me gjatë të saj kohë me shumëcu dhe me thonë kohën për me prodhu krime të të ne të qëfar do fushë, kryesisht letrare. Aleksandru ka orë në Prishtinë që një avë edhe ka në varë të mendajtë këtu edhe për tri avë të tjera. Sot, përpos pjesës e parë, ku do të njohim ma gjërësisht Aleksandrun dhe do të njohim pashtu dhe pashtu në ti që është një shkriptare dhe që ka orë bashkë me Aleksandrun në Prishtinë, Moni Stănilă. Më lëmë shumë e lumë tërë që bashkë me të dytë kemi me diskutu për prodhimet e tyre letrare edhe për përbujen e tyre në Prishtinë dhe pse kam vendosë ma orë prej Moldavis në Prishtinë. Atër para se me fillu, unë kësha pas që shkurt në Shqipë dhe ma ndeje këthejmë në anglisht për arsye se bashkëfolësit e mi më flasin në Shqipë. Me në prezentu të dytë, me prezentu punën e tyre edhe ma ndeje disa pytje vyrse që në ndimojnë me njohët punën e Aleksandrus edhe pse ka varë në Prishtinë dhe ma ndeje pjesa tjetër është lecim i krijimeve të Aleksandrus. Diku 8 poezi do t'i lexojmë, Aleksandru i lexon në gjuhën rumune, ndërsa unë do t'i lexojmë në gjuhën angleze, edhe një prozë të cilë është pësoj që kemi mëmbri me lecu krejt. Atër Aleksandru është poet rumun, originalisht vjen nga Moldavia, mirë po kohadën është të sinë rumune, kjo është një specifikë se në cilën e mësoha mas diskutimit me Aleksandrun, që se cilë qytetari Moldavis ka të drejt të rifitoj, jo të marë në shpecin rumune për arsye se vëdajtët që këto dy shtete endojnë një të kulturë dhe kanë qenë bashkë në një kohë. Kështë që Aleksandru nuk pëlqenë në thonë që e ka edhe në shpecin rumune, po nuk pëlqenë në thonë që e ka rifitu edhe në shpecin rumune. Aleksandru ka shkrujt dhe vazhdo në shkrujt prozë, është një të kohë dramaturg, scenarist dhe poezi. Bashkë me bashkëshortën e Timoni në Moldavi e u heqë një klub letrar që quhet Republika. Klubi letrar ka për qëllim, ashtu qysh e kemi mësu prej diskutimet me ta, pa për qëllim që në një ambjent si Moldavia me imbledrët vetës kryusit e rinë, kryesisht letrar, do me thonë është një varë në një bibliotekë komunale, ata më bidhen edhe kanë mundësi që se cili artist, se cili poet i ri me i ledzu kryimet e veta për para audiencës, audienca është e shumë lojshme, vinë njerës prej, është hapën për gjithë, edhe kur poetet ledzojnë, marin, si me thonë, këshila, marin feedback prej njerëzit të audiencës edhe kjo ka për qëllim që me ndihmu ata me u zhvillu letrarisht. Kësha do është me fillu mas pari me apo disa pytje Aleksandrus. This was just an introduction of both of you that I did in Romania so that the audience would get to know both of you and your work. Tashka do është me apo disa pytje. I would like to ask you a few questions before starting to read. First, this is a very general question, so I would like to know like, if you can tell us about your work, what you mostly focus on your work, and what are the topics of your works?
Hello everybody. I'm Alexandru Vakulovski from Romania, a writer from Moldova. My English is not good, but my wife is here, and he translates. Okay. Sunt foarte bucuros să fiu aici.
Nu, asta e, nu mai e repetație, direct despre ce scrie, eu traduc.
Ok. Sunt în Prishtina, vreau să-mi termin un roman. Naratorul romanului este un cioroi.
Dar să spui și despre ce te-a întrebat el, care e ce scrit în general.
Sunt și poet, sunt și poet și
pe ce te axezi, care sunt temele de iată prezentat la
poet. Și sunt și poet și prozator, am să vă citesc un fragment din primul meu roman care se numește Pizdeț. E un cuvânt din slangul sovietic. Din păcate pentru mine romanul ăla cumva m-a umbrit. După ce am scris Pizdețul, toată lumea, nu mai pot scăpa de el, toată lumea mă vede ca pe un scriitor controversat, dar mie mi se pare că sunt un om normal, nu un scriitor controversat.
Someone will wrote today, I will read today a fragment from my first novel, what's name Pizdeț, this is a word from Russian slang, but it sounds very bold in Romania and in Moldova, of course. And somehow, even if this novel makes me very well known in Romanian field, actually, it don't bring me so much luck, because now everyone who talks about me talks about that novel, and they even say that novel, they don't say the name. And because of this novel, everyone postponed me like a very controversial writer. Even if I'm a very normal person and a writer. But of course, that novel behind the title, it was a novel about the narcotics. And the people from Romania, Moldova, it's... It's like, I could say something more, because he's very modest, very humble. it's very easy for you to understand. It's like you go from Prishtina to study in Albania. And you go there, wow, my motherland. Mm-hmm. Something like, not fatherland, motherland. And you go there and you find some, every kind of misjudgment about you. Or maybe you are Serbian, actually. Mm-hmm. You live here in Serbia. Or you may be Alexandru, you are Russian. You Russian from Bessarabia, and Bessarabia is the historical name of Moldova. And it's a huge disappointment. And after you find there just narcotics, crazy illness, something what in Romania literature and in Moldavia literature was like, wow, this is not real, this is not mm-hmm. happening. But actually, Alexandru really made a picture of that age, what it was crazy age, was somewhere at the end of 20 years.
Mm-hmm. So it's like, if we put it in the context, it's like they glorified the motherland, and when they went there, they were disappointed
yes, yes.
by what they saw there.
Yes, because Alexandru was asked to learn Romanian with Arabian students.
Mm-hmm.
It's like in your country is not a Romanian, a clear Romanian language.
Mm-hmm.
And it's strange because he grew up in the Soviet, Union Soviet. Mm-hmm. It was with part of Union Soviet. And you grow up hearing your parents and your grandparents talking about Romania, the promised land.
Mm-hmm.
And you go there and you find just narcotics, medicine, forbidden stuffs,
mm-hmm.
and you get crazy and you get high.
My next question has to do a bit more about the with the residency. Like, why, for example, I would like to know why did you decide to apply for the residency, and what does it mean for you to go to a place so far away that has a much different culture from your own and write there and produce there? Is this like, is this detachment from your own culture that makes you more productive in your work? What does it mean to be away from your culture, that for from the culture that you're writing about in order to produce your work?
Acum vreun an am văzut că a apărut un roman a unui prieten de-a meu din București, Bogdan Alexandru Stănescu, care a avut o rezidență în Prishtina. I-am citit romanul și am rămas, nu ne-am parat uimit, că știam de Bogdan, un scriitor foarte bun, dar am văzut o forță în acel roman și m-am bucurat.
O pauză.
Ok.
Now, like 1 year ago, I read a novel wrote by a friend of mine in Bucharest, also novelist Bogdan Alexandru Stănescu. He wrote his novel here in the residence Prishtina Has No River. And I was not surprised, because I know Bogdan and I know it's a great writer, but I feel a different kind of force and energy to put everything in the page how he wants.
Și eram și foarte curios și de Kosovo. Țările mari, cunoaștem cu toții mult mai bine țările mari, dar țările mici tot timpul rămân pentru noi ceva necunoscut și...
Moldova, țară mică.
Da, și Kosovo fiind o țară cam ca Moldova, m-am gândit că s-ar putea să fie ceva foarte interesant pentru scrisul meu dacă aș veni să stau aici o lună.
I was even very very tempted about Kosovo, because we all know the big countries, we all know the history of big countries, but not often we think about small countries like Moldova is and like Kosovo is. And that made me believe, even if it's different culture, it could be some kind of feeling what could help me to write about my country from Kosovo.
Și deocamdată, cam așa se întâmplă, cum am venit, am scris două poeme destul de imense, cam cele mai mari pe care le-am scris în viața mea.
And it is happening, because when I arrived here, I wrote two poems, the biggest for my life, no, biggest like very large. And this is something new for me. And I could say for you that the Alexandru last book of poetry was with very, very small. We will see in this reading for today the size of the name of the book, and the poems are really, really small. And now he has a poem like 10 pages or something, 20, 12.
Și deja am vorbit și cu editorul și probabil că cartea de poezie va apărea prin aprilie, unde vom menționa că am avut o bursă traducție la o rezidență traducție la Qendra Multimedia.
Qendra. And I already talked with my publishing house, and I told them about the book, and it's possible in April next year to be published my poetry book. Well, I will mention that the part of this book was wrote in the Qendra Traduki literary residence.
Poate o să vă mirați, dar carte despre Ucraina.
Maybe it's something to ask about, it's surprising, but the book is about Ukraine. Not Moldova, not Kosovo, but about Ukraine.
And why Ukraine?
About war in Ukraine. Și după ce am scris aceste poeme, mi-am amintit că de fapt proiectul meu era să scriu un roman.
And after I wrote these poems, I remember that I in my appointment form I said to Qendra that I will write a novel. I will write a novel. So I read the poetry and I start to write my novel.
Și scrisul la roman a mers foarte bine și m-am mirat și eu că am mers pe o linie, romanul era început, am mers pe o linie la care nu mă gândisem din Chișinău.
And for sure it's very good to change the air, because this novel was started, Sandu, don't say the Alexandru haven't mentioned the time, but it's like 2 or 3 years. But now when being here inspired me, and I was surprised that I even changed the line of the novel, and it's really going in a direction what I want.
Narrator.
Okay, Putin is a character there, and the storyteller because the crow, you know, live like 300 years, and it's easy to start from Dimitri Cantemir, but it was a quite impressive figure in history, and to go till not just nowadays, but a dystopia 20 years after this moment.
În Kosovo, dar probabil că va ajunge.
And this crow wasn't by now in Kosovo, but I think he will be here someday.
So I wouldn't like to last it more with question. I just would like to talk about the literary club that you both run back home. Like when did you start this, and what is it? Like more details about what is it about.
Și eu
both
și
of you can answer this question since you both write together. So.
Eu să încep, sau vrei să încep tu?
Okay.
Și eu și Moni am avut înainte câte un cenaclu. Eu am avut un cenaclu în Cluj, acolo unde am fost student. Moni a avut la Timișoara.
La n-a fost a meu, dar da, l-am condus o perioadă împreună cu Bonanu, cu Eugen Bonanu.
Și dacă noi discutăm aici între noi și oamenii nu înțeleg bine.
Păi o să vadă domnul Bunaru pe internet și o să zici că Pavel Dania e meu.
Și
family joke, I will tell you after.
Și cred că a fost un lucru normal să înființăm și un cenaclu literar la Chișinău atunci când ne-am stabilit că practic Moni a venit în Chișinău imediat după ce am fost expulzat din România, dar asta e altă poveste.
Actually, we had before meeting together and form a family. We had a literary club I had, Sandu said, in Cluj. This is the Romanian city where he graduated. And I, Moni, have one in Timișoara. Wasn't mine. It was a kind of culture house for the students, and they have a very old literary club there, and I running there a time. Actually, I was managing this literary club, but the meetings was directed by a poet from Timișoara, Eugen Bunaru. This was our jokes, because some said it was mine, wasn't mine. After we meet, and somehow we want to do the same job like before, but we meet in very strange condition. We meet in Chișinău, where actually Alexandru was invited to talk about my first book in a literary meeting. And after I remain there, we get married, I move from Romania. And we start this literary club, but it was a moment when the director of the National Library was calling us every day. He said, I have a proposal for you. But we was scared. No, we don't want to work in National Library. What's that? And after half year, we said, okay, let's discuss about it. And what he wants was absolutely beautiful for us. He gave us space, gave us some money, a kind of small salary, and totally freedom to do how you want this literary club. So we manage in 8 years we have now with this Republica. We had invited already just Romanian, it's like 60, not 16, writers from Romania. We are very proud about this because we could really make cultural bridge between the young writers from Chișinău and the young writers from Romania. So it was more easy for our writers, young writers, to be well known in Romania, to be invited to festivals, to be, what's the name, looked for the publishing house from Romania. And actually it's just an accident when a writer from our literary club published the book in Moldova. We all publish in Romania.
Mm-hmm.
The readings public, it's more bigger in Romania.
Thanks. Does anybody have any question for this part? Or we can go on to reading.
Readings.
Would you like to start with the poetry or with the prose?
I think prose.
Okay. So we go paragraph by paragraph.
I want to write here. be a fragment from his first novel. That novel. You will see now why.
Afganul. Îmi plăcea să fumez cu afganul. Îmi povestea tot felul de chestii, dacă îl rugam, îmi povestea și despre Afganistan. Începuse să fumeze iarba acolo. Acum, nu că ar fi dependent, dar o fuma oarecum regulat, ca să se simtă bine.
Afganul. I used to like to smoke weed with Afganul. He would tell me all kinds of stuff. If I asked him, he would also tell me about Afghanistan. That was when he started to smoke weed. Not that he was an addict, but he used to smoke it quite regularly to make him feel good.
Când s-a întors din armată, din război, era cam diliu. Îți făcea sfoara cum vrei, dacă nu erai politicos, te puteai trezi cu un picior în bot sau aruncat peste vreun gard, deși era mic de stat. Asculta atunci aproape toată ziua muzică, iar seara s-a îmbătat. Mai trăgea și iarbă, dar atunci eu nu știam. Și o creștea singur în grădină. Mă miram la început de ce e așa de vorbăreț. Cum să nu fie, domnule? După câteva fumuri să tot vorbești.
When he came back from the army, from the war, he was a bit crazy. If you weren't polite, he might kick you in the teeth or throw you over a fence, although he wasn't tall. He listened to music almost all day long and in the evening got drunk. He also smoked weed, but I didn't know about it then. He grew it in his garden. At first I was amazed at how talkative he was. And why wouldn't he be? After a few talks, you can't stop talking.
Afganul spunea că a fost fain în Afganistan. Nu prea pronunța niciodată cuvântul război. Mâncam numai carne de oaie. Ne aduceau localnicii sau schimbam pe o lingură de aluminiu.
Afganul used to say it was full in Afghanistan. He never really uttered the word war. We used to eat nothing but mutton, he said. The locals brought it to us, brought it or would make an exchange for an aluminium spoon.
Iarba tot de la localnicii o aveam. Dar nu numai de la ei. Înainte de vreo luptă, li se dădea pentru curaj. Spunea că aveau o iarbă faină. Fumau și apoi nu mai știau ce e aia frică. Să tot lupte, să tot împuște. Pusese de câteva ori rănit, dar nu povestește cu durere sau ca pe ceva neobișnuit, ci ca pe o poveste auzită în copilărie.
They also got their weed from their locals, but not only from them. Before a battle, they were given weed for courage. He said that the weed there was cool. They'd smoke it, and after that, they didn't know the meaning of the word fear. They'd just keep fighting and shooting. He'd been wounded a few times, but it didn't pain him to talk about it. He didn't talk about it like it was something unusual, but like it was something, like it was some story he'd heard as a child.
Nu a fost războiul lui. A luptat fiindcă era în armată. Tot statul l-a făcut narcoman. Uniunea Sovietică, acum nici nu mai există. Pentru ce a luptat? Pentru iarbă. Pentru lalelele din munții Afganistanului. Afganul are motocicletă. Când îl vezi că țărate ea, zici că e nebun. Din Afganistan nu ar fi putut face așa chestii. Era prea mult nisip. Să tot faci acolo plajă, nu să umble ca în fotografiile lui îmbrăcat în tot felul de camuflaje. Erau faine hainele. Cred că erau din cânepă. Hippie. Mi-ar fi plăcut și mie să le am. Dar nu în Afganistan.
It wasn't his war. He fought because he was in the army. It was the state that made him a drug addict. The Soviet Union. It doesn't even exist anymore. What did he fight for? For weed? For the tulips in the mountains of Afghanistan? Afganu has a motorbike. When you see him perched on it, you'd think he was a madman. He couldn't have done stuff like that in Afghanistan. There was too much sand. You ought to sunbathe there, rather than go around wearing all kinds of camouflage, like in his photographs. The clothes were cool. I think they were made of hemp. Hippie gear. I'd have liked to have clothes like that, but not in Afghanistan.
Povestea cum treceau avioanele sovieticilor și bombardau, iar de urmă trebuiau să vină ei. Dar nu era ușor. Dracu știe unde apăreau basmacii și atunci era jale. Vedeai kilometri de nisip înainte, nici vorbă de o ființă, și chiar atunci se arăta vreunul în față cu Kalashnikovul lui. Te trezeai cioruit. Nu mai vorbesc de munți. Acolo degeaba bombardau avioanele. Acolo era adevărata lor casă. Era o capcană pentru noi. Dacă nu ar fi fost iarba, probabil că ar fi fost imposibil să ne miște cineva. Așa eram liniștiți, mergeam ca la film. Împușcam în stânga și în dreapta, având un sentiment de ireală. Când am fost rănit, nu am simțit nimic, doar că așa trebuie. Așa a vrut scenaristul. Slăbisem cu vreo 15 kg într-un an și nu plecasem așa de gras. Soarele ăla ne topea. Fără haine ți-ardea pielea, cu haine transpirai tot timpul. Eram de toate naționalitățile acolo. Moldoveni, uzbeci, evrei, nemți, ruși, lituaneni, cahol, toate naționalitățile din URSS. Știam cine e dușmanul, dar nu simțeam de ce luptăm. Ne fumăm iarba, luam automatele și alergam ca chiorii înainte. Știam doar că se va termina, dacă n-am să fiu ucis, că voi ajunge peste vreun an jumate, peste un an, peste o lună acasă. Atât. Așteptam să se termine armata, nu și războiul. Războiul era acolo dintotdeauna și, nu părea să se termine vreodată.
He used to talk about how the Soviet planes flew over and dropped bombs, and how, and after that they had to advance, but it wasn't easy. Then the basmachi would appear, and all hell would break loose. All you could see in front of you was kilometer after kilometer of sand, not a sign of life. And then one of them would pop up with his Kalashnikov. You'd find yourself riddled with bullets, not to mention the mountains. It didn't do any good bombing the mountains. That was where they were really at home. For us, it was a trap. If it hadn't been for grass, it would have been impossible to get us to go in. But as it was, we were calm, we moved like we were in a film, shooting right and left, with a feeling that none of it was real. When I got wounded, I didn't feel a thing, because that was how it had to be. That was how the screenwriter wanted it. I'd lost around 15 kilos in 1 year. Not that I was fat when I left. The sun melted us away. Without clothes, it burned your skin. With clothes on, you were sweating all the time. There was every different nationality there. Moldavians, Uzbeks, Jews, Germans, Russians, Lithuanians, Ukrainians, all the nationalities of the USSR. We knew who the enemy was, but we didn't really know why we were fighting. We smoked some grass, we picked up our automatics, and we ran forward like blind men. I knew that it would end if I wasn't killed. That in 1.5 years, in a year, in a month, I would go home. I was waiting for my national service to finish, not the war. The war would always be there. It didn't seem like it would ever end.
Se mai întâmpla să-ți memoară și câte un prieten. Era foarte ciudat. Odată a murit în brațele mele un lituanean. Ne împrietenisem chiar de la început. Era mare, avea vreo 2 metri și se ținea de șmecherii. La una dintre primele mele lupte, a scos o schijă cu dinții din scalpul meu. Când fumam împreună, îmi povestea despre casa lui, despre cât de mult îi place basketul și că speră să scape odată de armata, asta pentru a pune mâna pe mingea de basket. În schimb, pusese piciorul pe o mină și rămăsese din cei 2 metri ai săi doar vreo 1,50 m. Râdea atunci când l-am luat în brațe de nisip. Nici nu știu dacă și-a dat seama că moare. Poate i s-a părut că visează, cum ni s-a întâmplat tuturor. Mi-a zis ceva în lituaneană. M-a privit în ochi și a încetat să mai tremure. Pentru totdeauna.
Apart from the drug that our superiors gave us, we also got hold of our own stuff. For one of those colored bullets for fireworks, the Afghans would give us a hard green lump, about the size of a brick. You cut off a small piece and put it under your tongue, and then it would be, "Bye, comrades, I'm off home." A brick like that would last the whole battalion about a week. We were all like sleepwalkers, each of us talking in our own language. You couldn't understand anything of what was going on. So many languages, so many different occupations in the same camp. Nobody got angry with us. We were at war. We didn't really know why we were fighting. The only thing we were all waiting for was to go home already, to have been done with the army. One of the other things that happened was that one or other of your friends would die. It was very strange. Once a Lithuanian died in my arms. We had been friends from the very start. In one of my first battles, he pulled a sliver of shrapnel out of my skull using his teeth. When we smoked weed together, He would tell me about home, about how much he liked basketball, about how he couldn't wait to finish his army service so that he could hold a basketball again. He stepped on a mine. He had been 2 meters tall, and there was only about 1.5 meters left of him. He was laughing when I lifted him up from the sand. I don't know whether he realized he was dying. He said something to me in Lithuanian. He looked me in my eyes and stopped trembling forever.
Afganul e un băiat de treabă. S-a căsătorit cu prima gagică ieșită din care după ce posta lui iubită îl părăsise. Are copii. Nu-și bate nici copiii, nici nevasta. Poate de-aia toți îl cred cam dus. Cred că e fericit. Doar uneori când fumează pare a fi într-o încurcătură. Probabil ar vrea să șteargă ceva de pe discheta sa. Sau poate nu înțelege ceva. Deși vorbește uneori foarte mult. Nu știi ce se întâmplă în el. Arată uneori că atunci când s-a întors cu gâtul plin de sânge și cu motocicleta boțită. Cineva trăsese o sârmă la înălțimea gâtului peste drum.
Afgano is an easygoing lad. He married the first chick that crossed his path after his girlfriend left him. He's got children. He doesn't beat either his kids or his wife. Maybe that's why everybody thinks he's a bit weird. I think he's happy. But sometimes when he's smoking weed, he looks perplexed. Probably he wants to erase something from his hard disk. Or maybe there is something he doesn't understand. Even though sometimes he talks a lot, you don't know what's happening inside him. Sometimes he looks like he did when he turned up with his throat covered in blood and his motorbike crumbled, like he died. Somebody had stretched a piece of wire across the road at throat level.
Mi-l amintesc plângând, după ce se întorsese din Afganistan și se căsătorise. Se certase cu taică-său. Cum chis da mă, să zicea. Sau jucându-se cu câinele lui Tendel care se băga în fața mașinilor. Sau cum se îmbătase criță când aflase că are un fiu. Punea la toți de băut și apoi umbla după flori să-i ducă nevestei la spital.
I can't remember him crying after he came back from Afghanistan and got married. He'd had an argument with his dad. What the fuck he was saying. Or when he was playing with his dopey dog of his, which kept running in front of the cars. Or when he got blind drunk after he found out he had a son. He bought everybody drinks and then went to look for some flowers to take his wife in the hospital.
Afganul avea un prieten, Seri. Seri fusese și el în Afganistan. Spre deosebire de Afganul, Seri nu se adaptase la fosta sa viață de dinainte de război. Era prietenos, dar mai tot timpul biat. Din cauza asta se certa tot timpul cu părinții. De fapt, părinții îl certau. Atunci el se cățăra pe motocicletă și pleca. Toți se speriau când îl vedeau pe motocicletă. Mergea ca nebunul și era tot timpul îmbrăcat în hainele rămase din Afganistan.
Afganu had a friend, Seri. Seri had been in Afghanistan too, but unlike Afganu, Seri hadn't been able to adapt to the life he'd led before the war. He was friendly but drunk all the time. Because of that, he was always quarreling with his parents. In fact, it was his parents who quarreled with him. Then he would climb on his motorbike and leave. Everybody was scared when they saw him on his motorbike. He used to ride like a madman. And he always used to wear the clothes he'd come back from Afghanistan with.
Afganul avea prieteni lungi când plecase la război și era un pic de liniu. La întoarcere se mai liniștise. Cu Seri s-a întâmplat invers. Nu se mai tundea, nu se mai berberea. Asculta muzică și chinuia motocicleta. Se părea că asta e tot ce mi-i plăcea. Poate că și alcoolul. Nu știu dacă bea de plăcere sau din alt motiv.
Afganul had had long hair when he went off to war. And he was a bit crazy. When he came back, he'd calmed down. With Seri, it was the opposite. He stopped having his hair cut. He stopped shaving. He listened to music and rode his motorbike like a madman. Those were the only things he liked doing. Maybe drinking too. But I don't know whether he drank because he liked it or for some other reason.
Într-o zi, părinții nu au vrut să-i mintea motocicleta lui Seri. I-au zis că e biat să se trezească dacă vrea să se plimbe și că, în general, nu ar mai trebui să-i o dea. Ar trebui să o oardă. Face numai prostii cu ea. Bine, a zis Seri, nu o să o mai vedeți. I-a împins într-o parte și a luat motocicleta și a pornit.
One day, Seri's parents didn't want to let him go on his motorbike. They said he was drunk, that he should sober up if he wanted to ride and that they shouldn't let him go on it anyway. That they ought to burn it, because he only used it to get up to no good. All right, said Seri. You're not going to see it ever again. He pushed them out of the way, got on his motorbike and rode off.
Ce-a luat viteză a sărit la un dâmb din fața casei părinților și fiind la vreo 2 metri în aer, a întors volanul. Nu mai avea rost de chemat ambulanța. I s-au împrăștiat creierii peste tot. Au trebuit să treacă multe mașini ca petele de sânge din drum să dispară. În locul unde murise, părinții au pus o cruce. Au îngropat acolo casetofonul ce și-l luase în ultimul său drum serii, cu motocicleta și acum cred că se mai plimbă taică său, dar merge mai încet la curbe.
He picked up speed, hit a bump in front of his parents' house, and about 2 meters up in the air, he turned the front wheel. There was no point in calling an ambulance. His brains were splattered everywhere. A lot of cars had to drive past before the blood stains finally rubbed off the road. His parents put up a cross next to the place where he died. Under it, they buried the cassette player that Sari had taken with him on his final journey. His father rides the motorbike now, I think. But he takes the corner slow.
Thank you.
Can you read it? Who I'm about, or maybe you also died. Father, you were supposed to come to the city today. You were supposed to come today to me. But, Father, I waited for you to come to the city today. To take me home. Come earlier, my brother said. Father should come today. Today my friend left, and Father, I waited for you to come. I know I want Father to die. Father is sick, and you know I would like if Father killed himself. Today, when everyone was arguing, everyone laughed when I spoke. You know, I said I want Father to die. The sun made me sweat like an animal. I was in the desert and couldn't see any camels or people. I was alone, and I couldn't even dream of tired people crossing the sand like in novels by fowls. And I don't know why, Father, but I didn't feel sick. I knew you should be coming. Father, I heard you got really sick. Someone could say you're on the outs, Father. You have kidney problems, and today when I went on the balcony to smoke, the sky and the earth seemed like a large, unbearable kidney with stones instead of stars. You're sick, and I can't do anything, anything, but this, it's better if you die, Father. Dante traveled through hell, purgatory, heaven, to get to see simply the sky and stars, and you should die. Father. My streets have gone dark like thoughts. Today I'm only thinking about you. Yesterday I wanted to tell a woman. I loved you and I will love you forever. No one can ever change this for you. I can't. You can't. But these wandering thoughts weren't for her. And I get off the trolley bus. My legs start running. Truly everything depends on you. I don't know if you're there. But I want to get there faster, to open the door. And even if you were always so calm, today I want to open the door and unclench my fists. Father, I want to open the door and tell you.
This poem is from my first book of poetry. And now I read from the last book of poetry.
Recent, we hope
it's not the last one. Sub balconul meu se cacă toți câinii din cartier. Văd cum ies tipe din scările vecine și aleargă spre mine cu cățeilor grași. Se cacă și fug înapoi. Chiar și cățeaua roșcată cu puii ascunși se cacă aici. Primăvara e plin de păpădii.
Dandelion. All the dogs in the neighborhood shit just below my balcony. I see how girls leave neighboring stairwells and run towards me with their fat dogs. They shit and run back. Even the red-coated female with puppies hidden shits here. Dandelions everywhere in spring.
Printre blocuri. Un bătrân cu un obiect lung pe umăr trage de un cărucior. Toți îl ocolesc. De departe, mătura și căruciorul par o pușcă și un cadavru.
Between apartments, an old man with a long object over his shoulder pulling a cart. Everyone goes around him. At the distance, his broom and cart appear to be a gun and a corpse.
Ciobănească, burează, stropii se întrec cu frunzele galbene. Frunze de arțar, nucte-i catalpa, galben peste tot. Cad frunzele, beau fumez, iau pastile pentru soarta lumii. Am ajuns la vârsta la care nu mi-e destul să-mi fie bine numai mie.
Shepherd. It's drizzling. Drops competing with yellow leaves. Leaves of maple, walnut, linden, catalpa. Yellow all over. I am now of the age when it's not enough for me to be well on my own. Leaves fall. I drink, smoke, take pills for the fate of the world.
Balet. Femeile cu fustă care duc gunoiul sunt artiste. Cu un picior în față, o mână cu punga ridicată în sus, piciorul din spate ridicat. Cele în pantaloni, nu.
Ballet. Women in skirts who take out the trash are artists. One leg forward, bag in hand, raised overhead, back leg up. But those in pants, no.
Un moș cu aragaz. Printre blocuri, scârțâind, se apropie un moș. În cărucior care are ceva alb, de aproape văd că are un aragaz. Se apropie de containere, îl deschide, îl umple cu tot felul de bunătăți.
Old man with a gas cooker. Creaking between apartments, an old man nears. Pulling something white in a cart. Closer I see he has a gas cooker. He nears the bins, opens them, and fills them with all kinds of goodies.
Un câine balon. O femeie trage în lesă un câine tuns, pufos doar în cap. Ca pe un balon, doar din când în când, cățelul atinge pământul.
Balloon dog. A woman pulls a dog trimmed fluffy just at the head, on a leash, like a balloon, but once in a while the doggy touches the ground.
Grădinița. M-am trezit cu Anastasia în cap. Copiii de la grădinița de vis-a-vis strigă. Anastasia, Anastasia. Când eu îmi termin cafeaua, ei dispar la somn. Acum s-au trezit o voce revoltată și țipă. Demisia, demisia.
Daycare. I woke up with Anastasia on my mind. The children at the daycare opposite shout. Anastasia, Anastasia. When I finish my coffee, they are gone to sleep. Now they woke up with revolt in their voices, yelling, resignation, resignation.
Un bătrân. Un bătrân paralizat pe o parte a corpului duce găleata la gunoi. Alt bătrân își lasă căruciorul, îi ia găleata o deșartă. O mașină claxonează. N-are loc.
Old man. An old man paralyzed on one side of his body takes his bucket to the trash. Another old man leaves his cart, empties the bucket and takes it. A car honks. There is no room.
Thank you very much.
Alexandre, if there is anything that you would like to add, you would like to get to know. Otherwise, I would really thank you for this
thank you.
Hour.
Can you
put
your
comment?
No, it was a pleasure hearing these poems.
Thank you.
Thank you.